Welcome back to this series on Pre-cert Legends. This final episode of the year focuses on the sprawling history of one of the most influential of nasty distributors, at least in an art house sense, Palace Video. Whilst Palace Video itself started in 1981, the story itself stretches back much further, and this is where we need to start. We need to start with the stories of the founders of Palace. Short ponytailed working class producer Stephen Woolley, co-founder of Palace Pictures and Scala Productions with Nick Powell, was one half of perhaps the most dynamic duo in British films from the mid-1980s, and certainly the most well-known of the two. His passion for the movies from childhood led him first to selling tickets at the Islington Screen on the Green, then to writing for trendy entertainment guide Time Out, before being hired first by The Other Cinema, a left-wing collective short on marketing strategy, then with the Scala Cinema as programme director. But the story really starts with the lesser-known mastermind behind Palace's productions, Nick Powell. In the early 1970s, Nick Powell set up Virgin Records with Richard Branson, and in the space of 10 years, the pair turned a small mail-order record operation into a multi-million pound conglomerate. By the late 70s, Powell would fall out with Branson and go his own way. Powell had been a behind-the-scenes man, working alongside Branson, including for the punk era's biggest and most controversial album, Nevermind the Bollocks, Here's the Sex Pistols. This apprenticeship was a baptism of fire, and one that came very much in handy when it came to dealing with the controversy surrounding The Evil Dead. By contrast, Stephen Woolley's apprenticeship started right back at the source, the cinema. Beginning as a teenage cinema usher at the famous Screen on the Green, the young Woolley very soon began working at the very mecca of film lovers in the UK, the Scala Cinema. It wasn't long before Woolley worked his way up the ranks, and in June 1979, aged just 22, he was to publish his very first programme for the cinema. Says the man himself, "I had fire in my belly and wanted to create an alternative national film theatre, where you could laugh at Buñuel, weep at Cirque, and scream at George Romero. In that first month we showed all-night Judy Garland classics and the celebration of Gay Pride Week shoulder to shoulder with macho men such as Toshiro Mifune, Robert Mitchum and John Wayne. All manner of offbeat films were shown, and before long the Scala was to move to its most famous location, the suitably seedy King's Cross, in 1981. Whilst its location had changed, the kind of films shown most certainly didn't. High points throughout the 1980s include the world premiere of The Evil Dead, and a week of the entire Prisoner TV show, plus liberal dollops of Lynch, Cronenberg, Oshima, cult kung fu and zombie marathons, and the Cramps live on stage. So it was that 1981 was a very important year for both Powell and Woolley, because this was when they teamed up. With Powell's business savvy and Woolley's boundless enthusiasm and drive for cinema, very soon the filmic landscape in England was never going to be the same again. It is somewhat fitting that the very first film released on Video Palace, in November 1981, could almost be described as a signature release for the company, for it blended a heady mix of both arthouse and confrontational movies, both elements that would soon be Palace's trademark. The film, Pink Flamingos. Pink Flamingos was the first of many early John Waters movies to get a release in the UK, first at the Scala and then on video. Not only was the film itself controversial in its own right, but Palace's methods of distribution were too. Back in the early days of video, it wasn't just obscenity law that was just being brazenly flouted, but copyright law too. And Palace was right there with the worst of them. True to form, however, it was a law broken out of passion rather than profit, because Palace had decided that the best way for cineasts to watch their favourite films anytime they want, without astronomical rental fees, was to sell them the videos as cheap as possible. How they chose to do this was nothing short of genius. Palace would make an offer customers simply couldn't refuse. They would allow certain titles in their catalogue to be sold to customers at the discount price of £13.50, provided a blank tape was sent directly to Palace for the film to be duplicated on. I mean, talk about ballsy. Not only were Palace running a risk of obscenity with films like Pink Flamingos being released uncut on video, they were also running the gauntlet on copyright infringement too. They would continue to make this type of offer for many of their titles throughout the 1980s. Bearing in mind an average video release would cost somewhere between £80 to £100 for a video shop to buy, let alone any given punter, then we can truly say that Palace practiced what they preached when they proclaimed their love of film, and not just the profit margin. Pink Flamingos was one of two debut video releases from Palace in 1981, the other being The Loveless, which was now renowned director of Kathryn Bigelow's breakthrough film. So right from the offset, Palace was setting itself apart from the competition in the video market. Most early video distributors saw video as just a product, no different as than if they were selling stationery. This was most certainly not the case when it came to Stephen Willey, whose shrewd eyes for both cult and populist tastes would soon get Palace the holy grail of the pre-cert period. Like many other video companies, they soon became a powerhouse and would release a torrent of video titles over the following years. In 1982, there was a pause between their first tentative releases back in 1981, and July when they began distributing videos in earnest. Nonetheless, both Aguirre, Wrath of God, and Mephisto were both released at this time. Then, in August, the releases continued to grow in number. Taxi Zumclo, The Tempest, Eraserhead, The Enigma of Caspar Hauser, and Pixote were all released at this time. Art House fare one and all, for sure, but there is a few here that took some real balls to release, and at least treated the video watching audience with the respect that politicians certainly did not. Taxi Zumclo, roughly translated in English as Taxi to the Toilets, is a rather blunt film about a homosexual teacher who engages in risky sexual behaviour at night. Not to everyone's taste, but certainly not out of place in Palace's stable. Palace's video release of the film was the only official video release until a cut version was released in 1994. It had of course played at the Scala, and, like many films that saw the light of a projector there, was soon to see the electrodes of televisions when Palace followed up the video releases throughout the company's lifetime. Whatever Palace was seen to be as a company, no one could accuse them of being boring. Eraserhead, David Lynch's debut film, is a real head-scratcher of a film shot in black and white, and certainly not for mainstream consumption. It started life on the midnight cinema circuit in the US, and typified what Palace had which no other video company had: a dedicated cult audience. Lynch's rather extraordinary film is now considered a classic, but many people upon first viewing, myself included, had absolutely no idea, having watched it, what it was all about. Even so, it's a rewarding film for fans of the odd, and is strangely affecting. Certainly a film once seen that is never forgotten. The basic plot is that Henry, the eraser head of the title, is a loner that is about to become a father, but is fearful of the responsibilities. The baby itself is a deformed creature that constantly cries because it is gravely diseased, making Henry's girlfriend leave both him and the baby. Henry starts having hallucinations and is here where the remainder of the film takes on one long, beautiful nightmare. Lynch had made the film as a way of artistically expressing the fears he himself felt at the responsibilities fatherhood brought. And just to give you an idea of how ahead of the curve Palace was, they released youth crime film Pixote, a film that would pave the way for more mainstream accepted foreign language coming-of-age films like City of God over 20 years later. In September 1982, Palace released An Unsuitable Job for a Woman, Strozek, Basket Case, Cocaine Fiends, double-billed with Multiple Maniacs, Female Trouble, and Fitzcarraldo. Both Strozek and An Unsuitable Job for a Woman are typical art house fare, but Basket Case, Cocaine Fiends, and Female Trouble are anything but. Once again, Palace shows how diverse a company they truly were. Basket Case is a horror comedy classic whose success on video obviously whetted Palace's appetite when it came to offbeat horror comedy. Another oddity once seen, never forgotten. Both Multiple Maniacs and Female Trouble were other John Waters movies and pushed the envelope just as much as Pink Flamingos did. Multiple Maniacs was another rarity which did not get an official release until 1990, and once again only with cuts. It's a rough film to watch, but certainly shows where Waters' auteur status would lay. It has only just got an uncut cinema release this year here in the UK. Female Trouble is another classic which, as is soon becoming my soundbite throughout this entire episode, not to everyone's taste. The Bitter Tears of Petra von Kant, Diva, Fear Eats the Soul, Fox and His Friends, and The Honeymoon Killers all get a video release in October 1982. Plan 9 from Outer Space and Angel both get a release at the end of 1982. Yet again, these two releases show just how both low and high culture had a home within Palace's walls. Plan 9, for those of you that don't know, is considered the worst film ever made, which again showed that Palace wasn't just for beret and goatee sporting intellectuals, but generally went out of their way to get films shown that they liked. Desperate Living, Monty Montgomery and Gary Numan's Micro Music were New Year releases in January 1983. Desperate Living was yet another John Waters movie rejected by the BBFC, then cut when given a belated release in the 1990s. Indeed, my research indicates that after passing of the VRA, much of Palace's back catalogue had to be deleted pretty much overnight. Nonetheless, this was still a better fate than was met by the majority of Nasty Era distributors. Then came February 18th, 1983, a date that would forever live in infamy, for it was at this time that Palace released a film that would be both their blessing and their curse. Started when Stephen Woolley was shopping around the local film fair in the US in 1982. He had wandered into the wrong screening room, and the rest, as they say, was history. To the UK and implored Power to accept his word on his having seen the film that would put Palace on the map once and for all. Palace broke the mould and the ultimate Hollywood taboo and released the film at the cinema and on video more or less simultaneously. Whether the film was a success at the cinema, it was nothing compared to the success it had on video in the UK.
Evil Dead was such a hit, it was the biggest video hit of its time, of its year. I think it sold 50,000 copies in 1 year. Which at sell-through, which was I think between £40 and £50 at the time, was a £2 million grossing video. Video, as I say, boomed so big, so quickly.
But whilst dizzying success comes with maverick films like The Evil Dead, so too does the cold glare of the censorious. And Mary Whitehouse was soon going to nail The Evil Dead to the very masthead of her censorious campaign, labelling it the number one video nasty. And also she hadn't even seen it. This of course only pushed rentals higher, but soon the courts up and down the land would be dragging the film and its creator into the dock. The initial seizure happened mere days after its release on video by Manchester police, justifying the action by saying they believed that the video version was stronger than the cinema version. In truth, it was the same cut version released for both for cinema and video. On this occasion it was returned to the dealer with apologies from the police, but this wasn't the last time it would get its collar felt by the old Bill. Far from it, but more on that later. Meanwhile, lest we forget, Palace were still releasing other videos beside The Evil Dead. Shocking, I know. The Flying Doctors of East Africa was released in February 1983. Whoops Apocalypse in May 1983. David Bowie's Snooze Fest Merry Christmas Mr. Lawrence in July 1983. Gary Numan gets yet another music video release, with the touring Principal 79 and the Beatles spoof The Complete Russells All You Need Is Cash both get a release in August 1983. This is followed the next month by Fassbinder's Corel in September 1983. Kira Kurosawa gets a double bill in October 1983 with the releases of both Sanjuro and High and Low. The following month he gets yet another Palace outing with perhaps the most influential samurai film ever, Yojimbo. Then finally in December 1983 they released Big Meat Eater. By March 8th, 1984, The Evil Dead was being mentioned in the gutter press as one of the top 10 children's nasties. This point was mentioned again in Video Violence and Children, the infamously fraudulent report which was released around the same time. Not one to take this without a fight, Palace considers legal action against its author, Dr. Clifford Hill, for the way he'd singled out their film. Nick Powell gave an interview with Screen International on the 17th of March 1984, a mere 9 days after The Evil Dead's mention in the report. Quote, in the case of this particular film, there has yet to be a successful prosecution when defence has been made. The BBFC have made their judgment in granting it an 18 certificate, and we are now waiting for a jury to decide. The Hill Report reference makes it virtually impossible now for the film to have a fair trial. With hindsight, it's a shame that Powell didn't also plead his case to the mainstream press too, since the audience for Screen Magazine was cineast in taste and not the Philistines in the tabloid press that were soon to crucify his most important release. Meanwhile, Powell and Woolley tried to bring what was going on to the public's attention. On May 12, 1984, the now legendary 24-hour horror fest was held at the Scala. The lineup included Bloody Birthday, Hell Night, The Bogeyman, Basket Case, Death Trap, Extro, Human Experiments, The Blood Spattered Bride, Shock, and of course, The Evil Dead. The very next day, on May 13th, Palace rep Irvine Rappaport gives an interview to the Sunday Times and succinctly sums up the frustration felt by many distributors. Quote, "I've asked the police how we are supposed to know if a video is obscene, even if it has a certificate. And they said I should ask our solicitors. But when I asked if they had any more chance of knowing than I did, they said probably not." Once again, this was the case of very reasonable distributors trying to appeal to the better angels of the powers that be. The trouble was, of course, the powers that be didn't have any. Whilst it is easy for us in the present to recognise a political con in the Video Nasties debacle, it probably wasn't easy at the time. People, rightly or wrongly, still trusted back in the Nasties era that sooner or later, sanity would prevail. Oh, how wrong they were. Nevertheless, Palace was still releasing videos left, right and centre, with that sinking feeling getting a May 8, 1984 release, followed swiftly by the Streetwalker the very next month. The cherry on top was when the BFI gave an award for commercial innovation to Palace the following month, on June 21st, 1984. This was a way to show Palace that, despite its legal wranglings in the courts, it still had the wholehearted support of the entire British film industry. No other video distributor could boast such an accolade, yet still Palace was persecuted for the courts. On August 6th, 1984, The Evil Dead was still on the prosecution pending list. Derek Mann, chairman of the Video Traders Association, the VTA, went public with his disgust that there should be any list at all. He argued that a list that mixed successfully prosecuted with those that may get thrown out of court was to declare a film guilty before its day in court. He is quoted in the press as saying, "It is for the courts to decide if a film is obscene. Until they have done so, the film in question should have no place on the so-called ban list." Not that the powers that be were interested in fair play and due process, it was all about the press ink. Later this month, when a raft of acquittals followed in the courts, Mann followed up on this common sense argument, quote, "Increasingly, the decisions of the Crown Courts are exposing the wide gulf that exists between the public standards of morality and the views held by the DPP. We would hope that decisions like this won't be overlooked by the DPP when issuing future lists." Once again, however, voices of reason such as this were to fall on deaf ears, for once again The Evil Dead found itself in the dock. Meanwhile, Paris, Texas gets a September 1984 release in two alternate sleeves. One can't help but wonder, but if the courts had taken a wider look at Palace as a company, they'd have had a much more informed view of the people they were dealing with. Cyclo Video they most certainly weren't. On September 23rd, 1984, Evil Dead was acquitted in both Leeds and Bournemouth, yet still the DPP refused to take the film off the list. By now even the broadsheets were flummoxed as to why such a hullabaloo was being caused over the film. The Sunday Times, not exactly known for its libertarian instincts, wrote, quote, "Why is it that what is good enough for the film censor is not good enough for the police? It is to be hoped that the censors will leave the long, if slightly tatty tradition of Grand Wiganol alone. Soon films like The Evil Dead will be so censored on video as to make them worthless." But, alas, defences like this in the press were rare and drowned out by the hysteria. Later this same month, Nick Powell, along with his companies, are all charged by the Magistrates Court once again under Section 2 for The Evil Dead. The case is committed at Snaresbrook Crown Court in July 1985, a place and date that should be familiar to those of you that have seen episodes earlier in this pre-cert series, or indeed read the same books that I have. Meanwhile, in October of 1984, The Return of Martin Gere is released, followed by Brit Double Whammy, The Snowman, and The Hit. Meanwhile, on December 1st, 1984, both Grimsby Crown Court and Lewes Crown Court acquit the Evil Dead, which, for those of you keeping score, is the third court in a row to clear the Evil Dead. But hey, it's only public money, so why not piss it down the drain by taking the film to court until you get the verdict you want, right? Well, that was the police's mentality anyway. You'd never think that right at the same time in history, millions were unemployed and getting by on not enough to feed a cat on. Fucking England. Cop super dick Peter Kruger says as much publicly at the time, stating, "No matter how many dealer acquittals arise, I don't think the Evil Dead will be coming off the list before February." Which begs the question, why February? Why such an arbitrary date? What the fuck was going on? As ever during this period, no answers were forthcoming. But the DPP and the cops were acting like twats in a casino. They couldn't accept that the roulette wheel just wasn't coming up red for them. And just like deadbeat gamblers, they kept shoveling money that wasn't theirs right back on the table for more and more spins. Nick Powell was to say as much in his response to Kruger's fucking having his cake and eating it too. Quote, "I think it's ridiculous that every jury which has dealt with the film has cleared it and the DPP will still not drop it from the list. These verdicts will not have any binding effects on our court case because the DPP is so unpredictable. The trouble here is that Powell should have hit the law books and perhaps even had a chat with Furman, who during all this was doing what he does best and hiding. If he had done either of these things, he would have realised that by having a bona fide BBFC X certificate for the cinema, he was de facto insured against any prosecutions under the Obscene Publications Act anyway. After all, the whole fucking point of the BBFC, the whole reason for fucking being in the first place, was to decide what was and wasn't obscene under the OPA. By giving the Evil Dead, or indeed any film, an X certificate for the cinema, was supposed to be a stamp of approval in terms of the film in question being safe in terms of being regarded as obscene under the OPA. This is especially true if taking Furman's amendment into account, which deliberately brought film in line with every other art form and categorically provided a statutory defence for any art form that, taken as a whole, can be defended under a freedom of artistic expression. The Evil Dead wasn't given this courtesy, it would seem, simply because it was in a genre the curtain-twitching middle classes couldn't understand and therefore feared, the modern horror film. The Evil Dead muddied the waters further for these kinds of people because it was so tongue-in-cheek in its over-the-topness that the irony was that Raimi's parody of horror, which The Evil Dead undoubtedly was and still is, was just too sophisticated for their over-literal grey little minds to take. These people, after all, are the same kinds of people that couldn't watch representations of foreigners unless they were grossly over-exaggerated, like on mind-numbing TV so-called comedies like Mind Your Language. Unless the Pakistani character was wearing a turban, or unless the Spaniard character was dressed like a fucking matador, they couldn't get nor respect anything other than nearly as complex as diversity in their tiny little minds. These wankers were the same people whom thought the black and white minstrel show was good family entertainment and were angry that people rightly took offence to it. Anyway, I digress. A mere 10 days after the Grimsby and Lewes verdicts on December 11th, 1984, The Evil Dead is yet again acquitted, this time by Portsmouth Crown Court. The court took only 20 minutes to reach its verdict and awarded the dealer in question, Joe Case, his full costs for the trial. Fair enough for Mr. Case, but not okay for all the taxpayers who are funding all this, of course. The next day, however, Mr. Case is summoned back to court again and accidentally prosecuted for exactly the same titles he had only just been acquitted for the day before. Honestly, fellow Pre-cert fans, you just couldn't make this shit up, could you? Things finally went quiet for Palace for a while, in which time both Terror in the Isles and Jimi Hendrix Plays at Berkeley gets released in April 1985. The Best of Elvis Costello, The Man, gets a release 2 months later in July, which, incidentally, was more important a date to Palace for an entirely different reason. It was because, in the court cases of all court cases, and the one which no one less than Sam Raimi himself came to act for the defence, Snarebrook Crown Court finally acquit The Evil Dead on July 25th, 1985, after years of waiting for the trials to come to court. Judge Owen Stableford took the DPP to task and criticised him in his closing remarks. Quote, "I regard it as quite lamentable that in relation to a single film that there should have been over 40 separate pieces of litigation up and down the country. I am concerned with what this chaotic state of affairs does to the reputation of the administration of justice. Only two cases out of a record number of 40 found the Evil Dead needing to answer for itself, whilst the remaining 38 cases were laughed out of fucking court almost as soon as it arrived." Judge Stableford further put the boot into the DPP by criticising the opportunistic timing for the case, bearing in mind the VRA was in its final stages by the time the trial came to court. Not only that, he apologised to Nick Powell on behalf of the legal system for the DPP's refusal to drop the case a lot sooner. Just so we're all clear, in case I haven't mentioned this cunt's name before, the Director of Public Prosecutions at this time was Sir Thomas Hetherington. Ironically, he was appointed as DPP by the Thatcher government specifically to reduce delays in the criminal legal system. Well, he sure fucked up on that task, didn't he, Pre-cert fans? Nick Powell himself was quoted just after the case as being, quote, "extremely pleased for all concerned, especially for my own family, to have won the case, and I trust the DPP will now do the honourable thing and drop any further prosecutions, allowing the Evil Dead to be certified in line with the terms of the Video Recordings Act." Not that any of this really mattered though, because as of September, the Evil Dead was taken off the video shelves anyway. It would not be until 1990 that it would indeed be submitted again officially. Furman, as characteristically cautious as ever, would not allow Pallas to submit it in the interim time, because as ever, he felt that, quote, "the time was not yet right." In the meantime, Pallas just kept on trucking with four new releases in the September of 1985. The Coen Brothers debut, Blood Simple, The Coca-Cola Kid, The Grey Fox, and Violent Strangers. This was coolly followed by both The Flamingo Kid and Talking Heads Stop Making Sense in December 1985. Then things went quiet for Pallas as they patiently waited for the Nasties' hullabaloo to die down in order to get justice for their most famous release. Then came March 16th, 1987. This, however, was a bad date for Pallas, as it was then that Furman somewhat coyly indicated to the press that he was open to passing The Evil Dead on video, but only with further cuts. The following month, on April 3rd, 1987, Pallas had to dump their expensive and heavily advertised campaign for The Evil Dead's re-release because Pallas, true to form, wouldn't go along with a ridiculous cuts list submitted to them by Furman. Meanwhile, guttings for punishment as always, Pallas picks up the rights to Evil Dead 2 around this same time. Sam Raimi gets tons of bids from distributors, but stays loyal to the guys who stuck by him from the very start. Pallas would score both the cinema and video distribution rights for merely a token sum. Raimi had to defend his work yet again this same year to the Philistine British middle classes upon its release, and even turned up on awful British shoutfest programmes in order to put his case forward with the same quiet dignity and intelligence he always has. Talk about deja vu. Then finally, on the upteenth submission of The Evil Dead for video classification to the BBFC, the latter belatedly awarded it an 18 certificate after heavy cuts totalling 1 minute 55 seconds on the 15th of April 1990. It is finally re-released by Pallas in May 1990. These included the cuts already made for cinema. Those of us that remember that version remember it like being given a run-up to a joke but not hearing the punchline. I myself had to put up with a scuzzy Japanese subtitled copy of the uncut version until it was finally released uncut for Anchor Bay in March 2001. Pallas, meanwhile, continued distributing videos throughout the 90s. They re-released many classics such as Basket Case, as well as adding to some new horror titles to their stable. The jig, however, was soon up, as they soon went into bankruptcy in 1992. But not before, ironically, releasing their biggest hit, The Crying Game. It sadly wasn't enough to save them, though. Since then, Stephen and Nick are both producers in their own right. Nick has re-established himself with Scala Productions and has since produced Fever Pitch, 24/7, Last Orders and Ladies in Lavender. He is currently the director of the National Film and Television School while maintaining his position as chairman of Scarlet Productions. The Scarlet Cinema itself sold its last pair of cardboard 3D glasses in 1992 as well. In a single decade, film distribution and exhibition had been transformed. The concepts of repertory, double bills, late night screenings and creative one-off programming suffered the same fate as the characters in Night of the Living Dead. Stephen has collaborated many times with Neil Jordan, a relationship which began with 1984 as the Company of Wolves. In 2002, Stephen formed his own production company, Number 9 Films, with his partner Elizabeth Carlson, producing Stephen's directorial debut, Stoned, a Brian Jones biopic in 2005. So that just about wraps it up for another edition of Pre-cert Legends. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'd like to thank you all for once again for joining me. Just before the roll call of honour, may I take this opportunity to wish you all a Merry Christmas, and I will see you all again in the new year. Take it away, Palace.
Ni le bien qu'on m'a fait, ni le mal, tout ça m'est bien égal. Non, rien de rien. Non, je ne regrette rien. C'est payé. Allumer le feu, mes chagrins, mes plaisirs, je n'ai plus besoin d'eux. Balayer les amours avec leur trémolo, balayer pour toujours, je repars à zéro. Non. Rien, ni le bien qu'on m'a fait, ni le mal, tout ça m'est bien égal. Non, rien de rien. Non, je ne regrette rien, car ma vie.